Hello Spiffy Survivors, Kato Genesis here, bringing you probably the most anticipated Fallout 4 guide. This one will go over all of the unique apparel and armor you can find in the base game of Fallout 4, that is, before expansions. If you're looking for unique power armor or DLC gear, those have their own videos, which you can navigate to now from the card on the upper right or the link in the description. The criteria is very similar to other Unique's guides. I will only be covering things that are truly, traditionally unique, or that can only be found in one place. If the item in question is something you can find a copy of on a legendary enemy, those are just pre-placed legendaries and will not be included on this list. This guide will show the benefits of the equipment, quest requirements, and most importantly, where to find them. Speaking of quests, there are quest-related spoilers, and though I try my best to avoid them, it's simply not possible with this guide. You have been warned! Enough disclaimers, this is a pretty long list, let's get started. First to go over is a bit of a strange one, the Colonial Duster. Excluding the Minuteman hat because other Minutemen wear them. So Preston Garvey is wearing the only Colonial Duster you will find on an NPC, and being he is the easiest companion to gain as well at the beginning of the game, that is the easiest way to obtain the Duster. The only other way to gain one is by finding Anne Hargraves at the WRVR broadcast station, recruiting her to your settlement, and setting her up at a level 3 clothing emporium. But of course, not all of us are going to want to jump through that many hoops just to get a Duster. So if you would like the Colonial Duster, just get Preston as a companion and take it from him. He will forgive you, I'm sure. For the statistics of the Colonial Duster, extremely basic, it is a damage resistance of 5, with no additional attribute boosts, and disappointingly, it is not ballistic weave compatible. Next is a corset, which is worn by Kate, the face-crushing Irish bird, who happens to be found in the combat zone, south of the Boston Common and Swan's Pond. To gain her as a companion though, be ready for a fight. Once you are able to take on her contract, her armor is available for the taking, but doesn't offer too much when it comes to protection or statistics, giving the wearer just a boost to their endurance by 1. Unlike the trench coats, however, armor can be layered over the top of the corset, so it has at least that going for it. Third we're going over is the Grognak costume, and this is found in Huber's Comics, a comic shop to the southwest of the Boston Common. The costume is sitting in a locker on the top floor, near the roof access. The Grognak costume is catered specifically to melee users. It has a ballistic damage resistance of 10, with energy and radiation resistance at 15. The Grognak costume also has a specialized legendary effect that raises the wearer's strength by 2 and gives a huge 25% boost to melee damage. The Grognak costume is not a full outfit, but just a torso piece, so a helmet, arm, and leg armor can be worn along with it. If you were aspiring to be a barbarian like the man himself, this is the best choice. Next is the Silver Shroud costume and the Silver Shroud armor, which is first found also in Huber's Comics. On the opposite side of where you find the Grognak costume is a stage that should have a mannequin wearing the Silver Shroud outfit. Take it from the comic shop to Good Neighbor and find a ghoulish gentleman by the name of Kent Connolly in the Memory Den. Now, provided you agree to help him for the quest The Silver Shroud, he will give you an upgraded version of the Silver Shroud costume called the Silver Shroud Armor. And after the quest is complete, you will have opportunities to bring the armor back to him and have it modified again for even better damage resistance. So the Silver Shroud costume, when first acquired, has an energy and radiation resistance of 15 and raises agility and perception by 1, the hat giving a bonus to perception as well. After it is first brought back to Kent Connolly, however, he will return the more protective Silver Shroud armor variant, starting at a damage and energy resistance of 42, having the same attribute bonuses to agility and perception, but also now having the assassin's legendary effect, reducing incoming damage from humans by 15%. After completing the quest, you can upgrade it up to 3 times, minus the hat, raising its resistances all the way up to 87. This makes the Silver Shroud armor the second most protective outfit in the vanilla game. It also opens up unique dialogue choices in certain spots. Next is the Feathered Dress, which you don't have to venture far to find if you had just acquired the Silver Shroud armor. The Feathered Dress is worn by Irma, the hostess of the Memory Den. To obtain it, you may kill her or pickpocket it, but if stealing is your choice, the Feathered Dress will respawn on her in a few in-game days, letting you acquire virtually as many as you want. The Feathered Dress is a full body outfit with 0 damage resistance bonuses, but will boost the charisma of whoever is wearing it by 2. And even though it starts with 0 damage resistance, the Feathered Dress is ballistic weave compatible, so you can be persuasive and protected. Next is MacCready's Duster and Hat, worn by our favorite lamplighter all grown up. Now a mercenary, he is found in the third rail in Good Neighbor. A merc through and through, MacReady can be hired for 250 caps, which is negotiable if you have the charisma for it. After being hired just like that, his armor is available to you like the rest. MacReady's green cap doesn't provide any sort of damage resistance, but will raise the wearer's perception by 1 point. As for the duster, it grants a +5 to ballistic damage resistance and increases agility by 1. Just by how detailed this outfit looks, it makes sense that armor cannot be layered over the top of it, but MacReady's duster is also ballistic weave compatible. Next is the companion armor that takes the most steps to acquire, and that would be the red frock coat and tricorn hat, worn by our ghoulish mayor of Good Neighbor, Hancock. When you first arrive at Good Neighbor, you are introduced to Hancock, but if you wish to have him as a companion, there's a few steps you need to take first. Wander around Good Neighbor long enough, and one of the guards will speak of Bobby No-Nos, looking for someone available for hire to help with the quest called The Big Dig. Be sure the quest ends in Hancock's favor, and he will become your companion eventually. At this point, you would know that Hancock is a pretty charismatic fella, even for a ghoul, so his outfit does reflect that. The tricorn hat giving a bonus of 1 to charisma, while the red frock coat will give an energy resistance of 5, with 1 point to charisma and perception. The red frock coat is another piece of companion gear that is ballistic weave compatible. Next is the DB Tech varsity uniform, found in DB Technical High School. This is south of both the Boston Common and the Combat Zone. Get to one of the upper floors of the high school, and towards the north side, you can find the varsity uniform on top of some lockers. The DB Tech varsity uniform comes with a whopping damage resistance of 1. Definitely not its strength, but it does come with a luck bonus of 2 when worn. Also, when equipped, the varsity uniform only takes the torso and arm slots, so leg armor pieces can be equipped along with it. Also in the DB Technical High School, you can find the mascot head. It is worn by the leader of the Raiders in this area, Bosco. You can find him and his throne in the basement of the high school, and take it off of his corpse once he is defeated. The rather damaged mascot head does provide a ballistic damage resistance of 5, but you can also equip glasses along with it, unlike most other full-face headgear. Next is an outfit worn by Piper, the red leather trench coat with matching press cap. If the main story quest is followed to Diamond City, we could find Piper Wright, the fiery journalist who wears this outfit, having trouble with the guards over the intercom. Unless you've already found Nick Valentine. She will become available as a companion if you agree to be interviewed by her, which in turn makes her outfit available. Starting with the press cap, this is a unique variant of the newsboy cap that will add a bonus to intelligence rather than charisma. The hat is also more red to match the rest of the outfit. As for Piper's red leather trench coat, it has an energy resistance of 5 and boosts charisma by 1 when you are wearing it. Even though armor cannot be layered over the trench coat, the ballistic weave can be used on it. While in Diamond City, you will have the opportunity of getting Geneva's ensemble as well. Geneva is the secretary of Mayor McDonough, and her office is located in the upper stands, accessible via the large lift by the entrance of town. This can be pickpocketed off of her, and just like Irma's feather dress, Geneva's ensemble will respawn on her as well. This outfit doesn't normally have damage resistances, but will raise the wearer's perception and charisma by 1. The ballistic weave can also be applied to this outfit. Next is another obscure one, the tattered field jacket. There's only one known location where this can be found, and that is on the corpse of one Ken Standish, who is found in Jamaica Plain on the upper floor of one of the ruined houses. You'll know it when you see it due to the dead bodies of feral ghouls you did not cause. For as rare as it is, the tattered field jacket doesn't have much at all for advantages, granting 1 point to ballistic damage resistance and a whole lot of nothing else. Sticking to the obscure is Grampus Savaldi's hat, found in the Old Gullet sinkhole not far from the Malden Township. This hat is tied to the quest Fallen Hero that you get from Joe Savaldi at Bunker Hill. He is the barkeep there. Ask him for a job and he will send you to retrieve his grandfather's hat. Once you go and acquire it, it is statistically no different from a militia hat, giving a bonus of 1 to charisma when worn, so the only difference for this hat is its name, and then it's a quest objective and a quest reward. Next up is the Destroyer's Helmet, a reinforced combat armor helmet sold by the merchant Penny Fitzgerald in Covenant. Arguably one of the most well-fortified settlements there is. While this helmet is a pre-placed legendary and even part of a set, I don't have to specify that this is a helmet, and legendary enemies do not drop them. The Destroyer's Helmet can come with the reinforced combat armor mod, and can have damage and energy resistances at 13. The bonuses on this helmet also include the sharp legendary effect, boosting charisma and intelligence by 1. Speaking of headwear, next is Captain Ironside's hat. This is actually found in 2 locations, but starting with Captain Ironside's, you will locate the ship east of Bunker Hill on top of a bank building. This cannot be pickpocketed off of him, but stranger still, you cannot loot his corpse when you kill him, but you can ask your companion to. So if you choose the route of killing Captain Ironsides, you can obtain his hat that way. But if you wish to avoid killing him altogether, locate the Custom House Tower a ways south from the USS Constitution across the water, and there's a broken out store window nearby with a soldier mannequin inside. Here's where it gets weird. Captain Ironside's hat will be right underneath the rubble, and should be poking out just slightly. If not, you can bring Dogmeat along to find it for you and retrieve it. Either way you decide to acquire it, Captain Ironside's hat will grant a bonus of 1 to Charisma and Perception. While it is sitting atop your head, no captain stance required. Now for the Lieutenant's hat, this is also acquired from Captain Ironsides, but as a quest reward for finishing the last voyage of the USS Constitution. Help out Captain Ironsides and his crew all the way through, and speak with him after the quest is complete at their next destination and you will receive the hat. The Lieutenant's hat is actually a less potent version of Captain Ironsides' hat, only giving a bonus to Charisma instead of Charisma and Perception. But if appearances are what you're going for, it does look the same. Next is a pair of outfits, Agatha's dress and Reginald's suit. One of these are given to you by Rex Goodman at Trinity Tower after the quest Curtain Call. This tower is southwest of the Boston Common and pretty hard to miss. If the player character is female, they will receive Agatha's dress, and if they're male, Reginald's suit. Not to worry, the only difference is how they look. These do not have a damage resistance value, but have a large boost of 3 charisma. If you wanted a decent piece of apparel for those speech checks and one that's ballistic weave compatible, this is a must have. Next is Cabot's lab coat, and this is worn by Jack Cabot, who lives in Cabot House. This is just northwest of the Old North Church. If you go there and speak to Edward Deegan and then Jack on the intercom, you will gain entry to the house eventually. During the Cabot House questline, you will be able to steal his outfit from him, with proper pickpocket skill of course, but if choosing to go all the way through the quest and then betray him at the end, you can get it that way as well. Jack Cabot's lab coat is another basic outfit, giving just a bonus of 1 to intelligence, but if you think it should, ballistic weave can be used on it as well. By progression, the next one is Lorenzo's suit, worn by Lorenzo, of course. In some of the final moments of The Secret of Cabot House, you go to the Parsons State Insane Asylum where you will find Lorenzo. You have numerous options in this side quest of what to do with him, but like Jack, his outfit can be pickpocketed too if he's still alive, or taken off his corpse. But you can end up with it either way. Lorenzo's suit carries a bonus of 2 to Charisma, and that extra ballistic padding can be weaved into this as well. Next is a Submariner uniform and hat, which is worn by Captain Zhao, the captain of a submarine called the Yangtze, which is in the water south of the Boston airport. You can take this outfit from Zhao as soon as you meet him, by stealing or killing, but by stealing of course you'll be able to get multiples. The Submariner hat is actually on 2 individuals, the other being his first mate, who is a glowing one, whom you find further into the submarine. The Submariner hat has no bonuses to speak of, while the uniform will raise radiation resistance by 5 and grant a bonus of 2 to endurance. Ballistic weave is also an option. Next, only worn by the coolest cats of the Commonwealth, is Zeke's jacket and jeans, a unique version of the Atom Cats outfit. You can find Zeke and the rest of the Atom Cats at the Atom Cats Garage, which is northeast of Quincy. Find Zeke and get the introduction quest to join up. Complete the short tasks that the Atom Cats give you, and you will receive this outfit. Like the DB Tech varsity uniform, this only takes up the torso and arm slots, so leg armor can be equipped over the jeans. It also has a damage resistance of 2 and an energy resistance of 5, and gives a 1 point boost to charisma, as well as an unusual plus 4 bonus unarmed damage. No ballistic weave here, but with this outfit you might succeed in slaying the enemies with how cool you are. Next up is the Brotherhood of Steel officer uniform, which is worn by Paladin Brandis, a missing in action Brotherhood member, and in order to find him at Recon Bunker Theta, you must begin the quest The Lost Patrol, either from Captain Kells if the Brotherhood has already arrived, or by finding the battle site north of Relay Tower 0MC810, not far from Milton General Hospital. Anyway, Paladin Brandis is the only Brotherhood member that wears this outfit, and only when he is out in the field. It can be pickpocketed from him or he can be killed for it, but again, pickpocket means more than one. The officer uniform is jet black and it has a damage resistance of 1 and energy resistance of 5. Also like the other uniforms, armor can be layered on top. For the general in all of us is the Minutemen General's uniform. Sometime after the quest Taking Independence, where you retake the castle with Preston Garvey, later a veteran Minuteman will show up named Ronnie Shaw, and she can start you on your way to getting the general's uniform, through the quest Old Guns. In the last spot of the lower tunnels you will find the corpse of General McGann, and since he's not using the armor anymore, you might as well. Unlike most of the armor on this list, this one is actually battle ready, having resistances of 40 ballistic and 80 to energy. Both the uniform and the hat will raise your charisma by 1 each. While it would be awfully convenient, no ballistic weave here sadly, quite useful still. Next worn by the first enemy you make, Kellogg's outfit. It is obtainable after defeating him in the main quest, Reunions, taking place in Fort Hagen. Kellogg's outfit has ballistic and energy resistances at 30, with no attribute bonuses. A pretty neat looking outfit that a companion might better benefit from. Next are simply called Fatigues, worn by Desdemona, the leader of the railroad. She is found at the railroad's HQ under Old North Church. Kill or steal, stealing yields more. There are no defense values on the Fatigues, but since this is the place where you learn Ballistic Weave, yes, Ballistic Weave can be applied. The Fatigues also come with a bonus of 1 to agility. Before leaving Railroad HQ, you can also find the Tinker headgear, located on the head of Tinker Tom, another piece that will respawn when stolen. The Tinker headgear is one of the few pieces of headwear that will give a bonus to your damage resistance, this one by 5, and it will also raise the wearer's intelligence by 1. Around the time the Brotherhood of Steel arrive in the Pridwin, you'll gain access to a mess of unique equipment, one of the first being the Brotherhood of Steel hood, worn by Paladin Dance. The hood can be acquired after you are able to trade with him like other companions, after the Shadow of Steel quest. Even though its name implies that other Brotherhood members should be wearing it, they're not. The Brotherhood of Steel hood has a basic energy resistance of 2, and is a great insulator for power armor helmets. Next up is the Airship Captain's Hat, worn by Captain Kells, the one who introduces himself as soon as you arrive on the Pridwin. This hat can be stolen right off his head. The Airship Captain's Hat gives a bonus of Charisma and Endurance by 1 point. Also worn by Captain Kells is the Officer Brotherhood Fatigues. There are many different types of Brotherhood Fatigues, but the Officer type is only found on him. As per the usual, it can be stolen or taken off of his corpse, and the Officer's Fatigues provide a plethora of low defense values, 5 for Ballistic, 10 for Energy, and 10 for Radiation. It's better than 0, though. Another special set of Brotherhood Fatigues are worn by Captain Cade, nicknamed the Medic Fatigues. Knight Captain Cade is found in the med bay of the Pridwin. These are statistically identical to the Officer Fatigues, again giving 5 ballistic damage resistance, 10 energy, and 10 radiation, also coming with the stylish medical patch on the sleeve. Quinlan's armor is next, worn by Proctor Quinlan. You meet him also during the Tour of Duty quest while being introduced to the Pridwin's crew. Steal it off his back and you may continue retrieving technical documents for him that are so important. Quinlan's armor, when worn, will give a ballistic damage resistance of 1 and energy resistance of 15. Another is Tegan's armor, worn by the quartermaster of the Pridwin, Proctor Tegan. Place yourself in just the right spot to the side of his cage, and he won't be able to see you while you're taking his outfit. When equipped, Tegan's armor grants damage resistances of 2 ballistic and 5 energy. Tegan has another piece of useful gear called the Commando Helmet, which is in his shop inventory. If you are looking for skull protection outside of power armor, this is a premium choice if you can shell out the caps. The Commando Helmet supposedly comes with the Polymer mod upgrade, putting its damage resistances at 16 ballistic and 16 energy. It also comes with the VATS enhanced legendary effect, reducing all VATS costs by 10%. And even if you don't find the VATS effect useful, just the fact that it has a legendary effect boosts its defense values by 2. Last of the unique equipment worn by the Brotherhood of Steel is Maxon's Battle Coat, worn by Elder Arthur Maxon, the current leader of the Eastern Chapter. There is no reported time where you can pickpocket this from Elder Maxon. You must kill him to retrieve it. And that is good news for some of us, bad news for others. There's many occasions throughout the main storyline, no matter who you join in the endgame, in which Arthur Maxon is killable, even when you first meet him. It's simply a matter of how, and if you really want to. Maxon's Battle Coat is an officer's uniform combined with a stylish armored coat, and provides a ballistic damage resistance of 50 at the start. It also grants a bonus of 1 to perception, and as you might have guessed, yes, it is Ballistic Weave compatible. And at the top rank of these upgrades, Maxon's Battle Coat will be one of the most well-protected outfits you can find. But at what cost? Next is the challenging to acquire free fall legs that come with a unique legendary effect found in the Mass Fusion building. And these will appear only after you complete the Mass Fusion quest with whichever faction you chose to side with. So after the quest is complete, return to the Mass Fusion building and begin your ascent as far as you possibly can. Once you get to the upper floors separated by a giant glass panel, the traditional method of going up further would be with a whole bunch of jet-based chems and a jetpack modded suit of power armor while tapping the spacebar. There's an office way up high, only accessible through these ridiculous means. Strategically hop and jet your way up to Jack Rockford's office, and behind the desk is a safe. Unlock the safe and you will find 2 random quality combat armor free fall legs. These free fall legs can have anywhere between 10 and 18 ballistic damage resistance and from 8 to 16 energy resistance. The unique legendary effect of the free fall legs is to prevent fall damage when both are equipped. Not something you'll really have to worry about if you got up there in power armor. But they are unique, so they're on the list. Next is probably the most disappointing on this list, the only set of unique eyewear in the vanilla game, Liam's glasses. These glasses have a steep requirement of joining the Institute and not even touching any of the railroad quests. But if you decided to go with the Institute anyway, here's how you get them. From the quest called Plugging a Leak, you started by speaking with Dr. Justin Ao after Mankind Redefined has been complete. Dr. Ao is the division head of the Synth Retention Bureau. After getting through the quest, make sure it ends by framing Dr. Ao, and Liam Binet will give you his glasses. Liam's glasses are eyewear, so they don't give a damage resistance bonus, but they do raise intelligence by 2 and lower charisma by 1. Like I said, slightly disappointing, but if you're playing an egghead character, these'll do just great. The Mark II synth helmet is easy to gloss over, but available as soon as you enter the Institute. Once you do arrive, however, it is available for purchase from the Synth Requisitions Officer for around 700 caps. It's supposed to come with the nanofilament material upgrade and have damage resistances of Ballistic 17 and Energy 18. Also included is the Cunning Legendary Effect, which grants +1 to agility and perception, and again, since it's legendary, its defense values receive an automatic bonus of 2. While still puttering around in the Institute, there is also Father's Lab Coat, which you can acquire in more ways than one, thankfully. Obviously, being an enemy of the Institute, you can take it from his corpse or from his pockets right after mass fusion during Pinned, when you find him in his room speaking to the doctor. Understandably, Father's Lab Coat will raise intelligence of the wearer by 2, not providing any damage resistance boosts unless you decide to put a ballistic weave on it. But that requires being friends with the railroad. Dead last to cover on this list are the Institute Division Head Lab Coats. As the name implies, these are only worn by the division heads of the Institute. You'll find Dr. Lee, normally in Advanced Systems, wearing the blue variant, Ali Fillmore, the head of Facilities, wearing the yellow variant, Clayton Holdern, head of Bioscience, wearing the green variant, and Justin Ao, head of the SRB, wearing the black variant, which can also apparently be purchased from the Requisitions Officer. All of these can be pickpocketed multiple times, except for the orange variant, which you get at the end of the Institute questline, after Nuclear Family completes, you will find it in Father's office. The statistics for all 5 of the division head lab coats are identical, granting no damage resistance and raising intelligence and perception by 1 for the wearer. That, survivors, is what I believe to be all of the unique armor and apparel that you can find in Fallout 4 before the DLCs. This guide probably took the longest time to compile out of every guide I've done previously, due to the amount of second guessing to determine if something is unique or not. So if you do believe with conviction that something was missed and follows the criteria of this guide, excluding pre-placed legendaries that are just special by having a name, the most important thing you can tell us in the comments section is where to find it. You can find the rest of the Fallout 4 guides in a nice little playlist in the description, including the unique power armor guide, which I highly recommend. If in fact you found this guide useful, do whatever it is you see fit to show that, and if you want more like this, you know what to do. Thank you so very much for watching. This is Kato Genesis, your Wasteland Advisor, and may you wander the Commonwealth like you own it.